Morning everyone. So welcome to our BLiSC Science Cafe Special edition on Sci-Comm'erce with Arjun Kamdar. So the Science Cafe is presented by the Bangalore Life Sciences Cluster, which is comprised of the, I'm sure some of you all are familiar with the National Center for Biological Sciences, then INSTEM, which is the Institute for Stem Cell Science and Regenerative Medicine, and CCAM, Center for Cellular and Molecular Platforms. And you all can hear, right? Yeah, okay. So all three of these, we have a series of talks every month with speakers from each of these institutes. And this month we have Arjun Kamdar, who's studying in the MSc Wildlife program. And he will tell you a little bit about the program. And what you need to keep in mind is that you all are free to ask questions in between. Arjun will ask you questions to see if you're paying attention, all of that, all right? So we want to have it be as interactive as possible, all right? So without further ado, Arjun.
Thank you guys for being here. I'll just start with a little quick introduction about this idea. So Sci-Comm'erce was put together over the course of a few years because I've studied. Hello. Yeah, this is better, right? So I've studied commerce, economics, and accounts. And then I was always interested in wildlife and ecology, etc. So I made this career switch. And this idea is, I mean, there is a striking pattern. So this idea kind of stems from the fact that what we study in ecology and wildlife conservation, evolution is very similar to commerce, economics, and the principles are the same and the patterns are identical. And it's not only that, the factors driving these patterns, the causal mechanisms, are also very similar. So this is kind of to show that it's not an entirely alien science which is far removed from, you know, everyday life, but it is integrated and everywhere in everyday life as well. So that's where this kind of came about. And yeah, so it's trying to, you know, show that the different lenses through which we see life are actually not that different after all. I'll just keep referring to my notes here, so I follow a little flow. Right, so when I talk through this, I'm going to be drawing broad analogies from everyday economics to stuff, to ecology. And of course, they're not perfect examples, so they're meant to be just that, which is analogies. So, you know, when I say talk about evolution, there is no heritability, as you'll see further on, but it still follows similar processes and similar causal mechanisms. So, without much ado, this is the more of an anthropocentric economic world which we have created, you know, which is more what we deal with on an everyday life. And there is the natural world which we see. And we generally view these two as two different entities. But I argue that one, they're not two entirely different entities because they interact very closely with one another. And even at a fundamental level, the processes that shape these are very similar. Right, so this is going to be as interactive as possible. So please feel free to, you know, stop me if I go off on a tangent or something like that, or if you have any questions. Right, so let's start with how many of you over here have eaten a samosa? Let me check that. Anyone who's not eaten a samosa? Okay, great. So that's out of the way. Alright, from all those who raise your hands, can you tell me, somebody tell me what is a samosa? It's not a trick question, really. Just what is a samosa?
It's a yummy food.
It's a yummy food, exactly. Excellent. Can somebody tell me a little bit about what it looks like? Anyone?
Triangle.
Correct.
Fried pastry,
correct. Does it have something inside it?
Stuffed.
Correct, it's stuffed, right? So it follows all samosas from a similar body plan. Now, can you tell me what is your favorite samosa? Like, if I was the first time I'm eating a samosa, which one would you say, this is my favorite, you should try? No, anywhere, like, yeah, how about it? Chicken samosa, okay, great.
What's a chicken samosa, man? What's a chicken samosa? Who has eaten a chicken samosa? Oh, crap. No, it doesn't exist. There's mutton samosa and there's aloo samosa.
Mutton is the real.
Mutton is the
real. We can take this outside, okay?
No, really. What's your favorite samosa wala? Sir, what's your favorite samosa wala? Do you have one somewhere near your college, maybe? Jambu Pilla Kaka samosa. Perfect. Brilliant.
It's
Anybody else? Anyone else? Have you eaten a samosa? Have you eaten a samosa? Aloo samosa. Any particular place that you really like? That you would say, this is, you know, the world's best samosa?
NCBS canteen,
ma'am. NCBS canteen.
Best.
Brilliant. You, ma'am, your favorite samosa wala?
Aloo samosa.
Perfect. Albert samosa. That's also, yeah, absolutely.
Albert Bakery. Mosque Road.
Common ground. So we've come to the fact that there are several types of samosas which are not a homogeneous entity. Sorry, my bad. So it's not a homogeneous entity, but there are several types of samosas, right? And they're not all the same. Why? Why are there so many different samosas? You'll be as amazed by this as this lady here when you figure out how. Yeah?
Come to Science Cafe, we embarrass you.
This is with consent. For instance, when I was traveling through Gujarat, I ate a bunch of samosas and they were really sweet. I know it's not surprising, but it was surprising for me. Then I went to UP and again, they were really double fried and spicy. So, samosas are, when we talk about samosa, we know what we're talking about. But they're yet so variable. So, what shapes this variability? Why are they so different, yet so similar? So, this is the form of, the way a samosa is a function of the taste and preferences of the consumers in that area. For instance, the sweet samosa in Gujarat has been reinforced by people, you know, voluntarily choosing that samosa. So there's a positive feedback loop where people are asking for that and that's kind of shaping itself. In UP, the factors are different, right? Of course, this could also be just by chance. Maybe one samosa wala in Gujarat, say, just added sugar, nobody really had a problem. And it just fixed in the population of samosas, right? Which is a concept that we call genetic drift. But on the whole, this is a concept of speciation, about why species are where they are. So species also are shaped partly by the environmental conditions that exist, which is rainfall, temperature, interactions with other animals, predators, humans. So all of these things can give rise to species. And to give you further insight about what this exactly entails, I'll touch upon a really interesting kind of speciation. So speciation is of several different kinds. But one of the most exciting ones is the ones that we find, say, along the Western Ghats. It's called Sky Island speciation. So there are these crabs that you can see. Can we dim these lights, please, if that's possible?
Can we dim these lights? Just the one near the...
Yeah, that's great. So these are all crabs, but yet they're all so different. Right? They're all along the Western Ghats, which has similar rainfall, similar temperature conditions, and similar host of other variables, right? But yet they're also different. So this is because of something that we call, that biologists call Sky Island speciation. So which means that for a crab, the mountaintop that it is on is, maybe they had a historic range, maybe they didn't, but the mountaintop that it's on is a sea apart from the next mountaintop where it can exist. So the gorge in between is as insurmountable as a sea. Therefore, it is like an island in the sky, and which has given rise to these, because these crabs cannot interbreed, cannot exchange genes, cannot you know, form a contiguous population. Therefore, they've been left in the remnants. So, in addition to the environmental conditions, the fact that they are isolated is giving rise to these kind of things. And it's not only with crabs. So, this is just this is some of the work that I was involved with, where we found a bunch of these crabs all along the Western Ghats, similar elevations again, but yet they look very different and are different species. So here again, a representation of the Isles of Skye Islands. So for instance, this crab, it's found only in a 2 square kilometer radius on the entire planet. Even though, just as the crow flies, 800 meters away is another mountaintop with identical conditions. So it's just really fascinating. And this has been seen also in birds. This is some brilliant work by Dr. Robin, where they found that in Kerala, Palna, gap kind of has created a barrier which these birds do not cross, and has given rise to these different species over time. Similar work again on frogs by Vijay Kumar. So the Western Ghats are a really rich place in terms of this. So yes, any questions about Sky Islands, about species, crabs? Yes?
Someone pass
him
the mic, please?
Yeah, sure. Okay. That's a really valid point about how they disperse too, right? Because if they can manage in the dry season, then they should be able to disperse in some sense. But truth is, we don't know much about these crabs in particular. They are of an entirely different family. So we really don't know what's happening there, and work has just started happening. Although there are suggests, some scientists who worked on this say that the crabs aestivate, which is they go into a form of summer hibernation, and they kind of, are in those pockets.
Such islandized population for crabs, wouldn't there be a risk that there would be less and less genetic variation, so they'd be eventually breeding with siblings, and
absolutely,
then the population would keep going lower and lower and lower.
Absolutely.
Then they get eliminated.
Absolutely. So that's when inbreeding depression kicks in, that's a term. So absolutely, that could happen, but so far it's not. Maybe these populations, though are in a tiny geographic area, the number of individuals are great. And this also depends on the amount of mutations that exist in the population. So I think that is something that a geneticist will give you a proper answer for, which I am not familiar with. Yes. So yeah, the samosa can give some really interesting insights about ecology. That's a good one. No idea. Maybe there are some forms of convergent evolution too, right? So. Cool. Now we'll talk about branding strategies. This I'm sure everybody around us has definitely seen. So, how many of you are interested in butterflies or insects around here? Anybody? Yeah? Alright, awesome. Sure, friends. So you guys will be able to back me up on this. These are butterflies that we see around Bangalore fairly commonly, right? This is something that we see. Quick question, how many species do you think are shown in this photograph?
3?
No.
3.
3? Okay, I hear 3. Somebody else? Someone 3. 4. Anyone else? This is the common mormon. That is also the common mormon. And that is the common rose, crimson rose of common rose. Sorry. So there are these three species. So the interesting thing is that the roses, these ones, are unpalatable. So they have a kind of toxins in them which makes them very unpalatable to predators. And therefore, so if a predator eats one of the roses, it will chew on it or maybe eat it and then feel really sick and it will spit it out. So it's a toxic one. The common mormon though is not toxic at all. It is just itching, copying these ones, it's just itching on these guys, defense and playing itself out. So it's just a cheater in the system. And this is happening all around us in Bangalore itself. And here's another example. How many species here?
Three.
Awesome.
That's it.
So yeah, so again, that's right, there are three species here. These two are the same. Unbelievable, right? The male and the female. So what is happening here? Here, palatable, these are unpalatable. These are actually very interesting, they get their toxins from the milkweed plants. So when they're caterpillars, they feed off these toxic plants and the toxins then accumulate in their body, which makes them really unpalatable. So a predator is not born knowing that this is wrong. It probably learns over the course of its life that these are unpalatable. And therefore, a predator is less likely to chew on this one because it looks identical. So there are these well-established, honest signals. There are these well-established signals in ecology where the predators have learned which these cheaters are hitching a ride on. And if you think of this, this is not too unfamiliar with what we see around us every day, right? This is Nescafe. This is the original one. But then there are mimics of it. Some pretty good. Some maybe not that good. And here is something my friend and roommate Farah is highly allergic. So he has a stack of allegras. And sometimes he gets a rare allegra in it as well. Here again, some good mimics, some fairly okay mimics. This may pass off. This also may pass off.
Find your stupid friends and give them this. Clever
face. Four is better than one.
All four faces. Yeah, so there are some really, these are some really good mimics, like these ones. Some which we've seen everywhere, they're not that good. And some need a lot to work on. Alright, how many of you, there are some more. So this doesn't only exist within a particular group. Right, what is this? Quick.
It's an ant.
Correct, ant. Alright, those know the answer, man. But this is actually a praying mantis. I'll zoom in a little bit more. There, you can see this is just mimicking an ant. Even cooler, something that you will for sure see in Bangalore, anywhere around the edges of your house or your building, where there's a little bit of, where there's an ant's trail, is this. What is this? It's an ant. Too many colleges here. That's an ant mimicking spider. There. Now can you see the eight legs?
Yes.
Eight legs. And several eyes. So this is, yeah, this is the ant mimic spider. It hangs around these ant trails and picks them up. And the ants don't know that, well, it's a spider. It's a wolf in sheep's clothing kind of a thing. So, yeah. That's it. Why make in India when you can fake in India? Economic Times ran this article, so, okay. Right, so how many of you have been to hill stations around Bangalore? Anyone gone to Nandi Hills? Yes, awesome. Anyone who's gone to Munnar? Great, awesome. So anybody who's gone to Munna like several years before somebody or any hill station practically? Munna, yeah. How many years ago did you go?
Maybe 5 years ago, and then before that maybe 10 years.
Yeah, so before that maybe 10 years ago. Could you like describe what was Munna like 15 years ago?
It was mostly TSAs, and the part of Munnar I went to was also, there was some forest also. But I didn't see so much of change that between the two sides.
Anyone else? Okay, so let's go through then Nandi Hills. Here's Nandi Hills. Here's Munnar and all of that. I don't know, I've always heard this, you know, whenever I speak. They say, in our time there was nothing over here, there was just two shops, and now it's become an entire market. Which is a very interesting concept to think of it. How does this transition take place, you know, from a very small place with a few shops to a full-fledged market with resorts, hotels, etc. So that's an interesting concept. That's Munnar now, that was Munnar then, that's Munnar now, so many hotels. How does that happen? And chai shops too. So, what we typically see is that a place which is developing as a tourist spot or just a business venture, for instance, the new road from the airport to the city, it's a fairly new thing. So, what happens? First, the chai shops come in, then the cigarette BD shops come in, maybe a couple of pakoda walas come in, maybe a little bigger enterprise of somebody who's selling American sweet corn or something like that comes in. Samosa wala, absolutely, exactly. So all of those things come in, and then that gives way to like bigger and bigger things, which is very similar to a concept in ecology called the pioneer species. So when there is a piece of land that is degraded or that is being recolonized, has been disturbed, has been cleared, the first species to come in there are those that we call pioneer species. They're species like small undergrowth shrubs, Macaranga trees, stuff like that. They come in and why do they come in? That's a very interesting thing, because a little bit of life history is incorporated into this. So they are the easiest to disperse, which is very similar to chaiwalas. They don't have high capital needs, right? So they can just disperse very easily and establish themselves. And then these trees help create micro climates for other species to come in and establish themselves. So they help fix nitrogen, they help create microclimates in terms of stabilizing the temperature so that there are not too many extremes. As we've seen, frost plays a very important role in colder places. So these kind of things come in and they create microclimates, which then give way to later successional species to come in and establish themselves, like old growth forest and things like that. So yeah, so that's how they come in. And the most interesting thing, why I think chai shops are like pioneer species, is because chai shops are not simply correlational. It's not just that chai shops come in when there is an open opportunity, but they are also used as cues by the larger hotels to set up shop, to gauge the potential market, to gauge whether there is enough of a turnover, enough of a revenue to be sustainable. So this is a cue that they are using, which is again very similar to what we see around. So yeah, here's an image of that. Then why do they, I mean theoretically, they should kind of just die out, right? After they've created this microclimate, what happens is they get outcompeted, because the guys that they've gotten in, which is the trees, etc., are way better at securing nutrients and space. So they get outcompeted and they're out. But then we ask the question, why is that happening? I mean, then over a span of time, over so many iterations, it should be, I mean, we should find no more pioneer species, right? If they can only be where there is disturbance. But that's exactly it. It's a very dynamic system. So there will always be small nooks and crannies where these pioneer species can establish themselves. So yeah, that's another parallel. Any questions about this?
So how many of these pioneer species are nitrogen?
I don't know the stats, but a large part of them is, some people say that clovers from the family of clovers, probably not the ones we see anyway, but the family of clovers are nitrogen fixers. So that's why when you go, you see a little bit of undergrowth and then you see a suppression there. Yes?
So the pioneer species mostly in the
more that information.
Absolutely. So they are the best suited. So there are different strategies that they've adopted, which is one, they are more suited to disturbances. So where things are very uncertain, things are little low in nutrients, they are over the span of time, over several thousands of hundreds
so
of thousands. So over hundreds and thousands of iterations of generations in several years is how they have evolved to have this kind of a strategy, where they are more focused on exploiting these small things and then turning over. So they are fairly adaptable in that sense. Yes, absolutely. Which is very similar to chai wala. Exactly. Altruism? No, I don't think so, because it's from a very personal. So altruism is where there is an act of good, a good act just for the sake of being, with no incentive to the individual. So I don't think this would be an act of altruism, because it is establishing itself and propagating itself too. So once it establishes, it's also reproducing and spreading seeds, etc. So I wouldn't go to call it altruism. If I have that mic back, this echoes a bit too much. Any other questions here? Yes.
You said something about chai wala as being like people engaging from the chai wala's and other.
Yes, so that's a very interesting thing. So where are you from, sir? You make it to Gurgaon.
Yes.
The hill station, or on the way to Pune, basically. Anyone else done that journey, Mumbai to Pune journey?
Mumbai to Pune.
Yeah. Right. So as you go on the ghat, there was a new ghat made, the new mountain road made. And it was a wide one with a little bit more buffer, etc. And a lot of these shops came up, all these, you know, as usual, the chai wala's were the first to set up, and the pong and all of those guys. And then we saw that after a point of time, the places where these chai shops particularly were situated were the ones where they have been outcasted, in the sense that those areas have been taken and are more established, instead of a tin shed and you know, just a stuff, it's been replaced by more concrete stuff. So somebody has looked at that. So maybe it could be correlation in the sense that that area is just good for business in general. But even then, an entrepreneur would also look for some other cues, in the sense that, oh, there is already an existing demand, there is already people stopping here, so it makes more sense to set up shop. So they're gauging the demand, the potential of the place through that. So, through this talk already, we've touched a little bit upon biodiversity and why there is so much biodiversity around, etc. And I'm sure that in all of these debates that we heard about, you know, conservation, climate change, ecology, etc., we always hear about diversity, diversity, diversity. Every ecologist and conservationist harps on diversity. So why would this exist? I mean, so what if one, you know, butterfly over here or one frog over there goes extinct? Big deal, right? I mean, we've got an economy to look at. So, there is a ton of diversity here. And why do we need so much, and why do ecologists continuously talk so much about diversity is a question that has been bothering me for a while. And to understand this, I think we need to take a quick look back at the stock market or at the investments market, right? So diversity sounds good, it's nice to look at, but no, it wasn't a convincing enough argument for me. So if we go head over to the investments market for a second, and how many of you over here have invested in a share, bond, investment, etc.? I lose track and I jump over myself and I miss the punchline, so I don't know. So can anyone here tell me of a company that they think is going to do phenomenally well, which is a really good company and, you know, it's definitely going to grow and
Reliance,
exactly, brilliant. Reliance, awesome. Exactly. Yeah. Google, excellent example. Awesome. So if I were to tell you that, you know, here's all your savings, why don't you put all of them in one share? In one, let's say put it all in Reliance's share. The share is going to grow, right? What could go wrong? How many of you would do that? Put all of your savings in one share? Nobody? How many of you would not do it? Right, paying attention. Good, good. Awesome. Awesome. So, yeah, why would you not do it? Absolutely, exactly. There are lots of contingencies, right? Maybe within the functioning of Reliance itself or the market in which it exists, correct? And that is why something known as mutual funds has come up, which is you take a bunch of shares, you diversify your portfolio where you don't invest entirely in one company, but you invest in bits and bits and bits of other several other companies. So that way you are buffered against a potential mishap in the market, right? So you're buffered in case maybe the share kind of goes whatever. We've discussed that already. So in case one share fails, if Jio or Reliance fails, at least you know Airtel will buffer you, or another share from an unrelated thing will kind of buffer you. Will maintain the functioning of the market, of your portfolio, and you will not suffer that drastic hit. Which is exactly the same reason also, there is also a moral reason, but there is also the main reason why people keep talking about diversity is because of this insurance effect or this portfolio effect, which is again established through several years and several hundreds of studies in ecology, which says that more biodiverse ecosystems are more resilient and more able to withstand changing environments and contingencies. So, and I mean, I read this and I said, wow, this makes sense. Yeah. Sorry, questions?
So I can sometimes so I can actually supply an example, intermediate between commerce and nature in a sense. So like with bananas, the
Hold it there. We'll come to that in just 5 minutes. Yes, that's perfect. That's exactly. So exactly what Vedo was saying, right? That this is this sounds like this sounds a little bit, you know, theoretical. Yeah, but you know, one species, I mean, come on, it doesn't really matter. But only it would be a conspiracy theory and a really good one if it hadn't already happened. So it's happened with viruses in lions in the Serengeti and now in Gir. It's happened with, anyone can guess what this is?
Potatoes,
exactly, the Irish potato famine. They had 16 different varieties, but they chose to, 16 to 20 different ones that they would regularly grow, but they chose to grow the 4 most lucrative ones. And then a blight hit and it was all white thing and it gave rise to the Irish potato famine. We've seen that a bunch of agricultural studies are actually suggesting that since we have identical crops, genetically modified ones, and even the ones that are just particular strains, they are more prone to infestations such as by the army worms and other such invasives. And as Vidur mentioned, bananas. So bananas, I think, is crazy, right? So like we mentioned, we spoke about Reliance. How would you feel if I said that 99% of 47% of the entire, say, telecom industry or whichever industry Reliance is in is owned by Reliance? 50%, close to 50% of the market is by one single person. It would give us the jitters. We wouldn't want to be, we wouldn't say that's a very good strategy to follow, right? Why is that? The thing is that the same thing has happened with bananas. So what I did is I got a bunch of friends from all over the world to send me photos of bananas, because 99% of all exported bananas are of this one particular strain called the Cavendish banana, which you will see. Well, that's New York, that's Noida, Switzerland, Toronto, New York,
lots from New York. Arizona, somewhere in the US, Brazil, the UK, they're all the same. Isn't it crazy? But I'll tell you what's more crazy.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what's more crazy is that and just to prove to you that I've not just gone to supermarkets and taken these photos and I'm passing it off. Here are photos of them from all over. After doing what's happened to the banana. Divya is very happy. He's also quite happy. I don't know why Mukta is very happy. She, yeah, so the crazy thing is that this would be, we could probably have this mistake. Only if it hadn't already happened previously. The same thing happened with the strain of banana that was there before this, the Gros Michel banana, which was the strain that everybody used to grow. Countries world over grew this one particular strain called the Gros Michel because it was the most palatable and it used to, the tastiest, very sweet apparently, and used to withstand, could withstand export, you know, the tough conditions that are thick covering. But the same thing happened previously. And it's happening again. And what's worse, it's the same strain of the blight that hit. So what happened is, it's what's called the Panama disease or the Panama wasting disease, called a blight called the Fusarium blight, hit these bananas. And since they were all genetically identical, it just wiped through the entire even countries. So that's where not only from this, but also for a country that's heavily reliant on one single commodity, the term banana republic has come about. So that's again this. And it has happened with bananas already in the past. It's destroyed farmers, destroyed economies, and yet we are indulging in the same mistake. Yeah, that's an example of all the measures that were tried, you know, to spray fungicide over it, but the blight is really resilient and it resides in the soil. Yes, Sudhir.
Can you pass the mic, please?
Just a minute.
So you showed just the various places in the world and you also showed European, Mumbai, so on. For focus on that stuff, because we are home to a whole bunch of banana varieties, but still within India, even over the past decade, you can see the robust are just.
Absolutely, absolutely true.
Spreading, like here, hostel, there's a shop entirely devoted to banana. When I looked in there, I didn't see any small ones, red ones, green ones.
Absolutely, absolutely true. And it's really surprising because so banana is indigenous to the Indian subcontinent also. So in the northeast, elsewhere, we've got our indigenous varieties which are fairly good, but I guess they're not as sturdy and the yields are much lesser. They're not as hardy for transport is the issue. We have a really wonderful banana called the Venusia, I think Musa Venusia, which was probably looked at as an alternative to the Gros Michel, but that didn't pick up. And I was unfortunately unable to find the production numbers about particular strains in India. But I mean, from looking around and from going over, I think it's fairly uniform, which is really surprising. So yeah, again, bye bye bananas. And it's really funny because when this happened in the 1900s, again, there was a song called "Yes, We Have No Bananas," which was made by the US because the blight hit all the countries that they used to import from. So that's the scale at which it happened. And yeah, like Vidur mentioned, right, we've got a bunch of, this was in Kerala, and yeah, there are a bunch of indigenous varieties which will be a buffer against this. So yeah, so this is pretty much just like nature fronts, right? It's a defense strategy. And you want to play it safe, also maximize your returns, but play it safe. So maybe have a few varieties that you are propagating, not just one. So, mutual funds most likely sahi hai. Aside note, I asked one of my friends, can you tell me, I was just telling him about this idea, so I told him, can you tell me what's similar between bananas and mutual funds? So he very bravely tells me,
so,
So yeah, that kind of covers all the four broad topics that I wanted to talk about today. But just to reiterate, I would like to say that this is that ecology and economics are firstly not two different things that are still shaped by similar processes probably, but they also interact at many levels. So we'll talk about that a little bit more in detail. And we also are integrated in the sense of the entire ecology shapes economies, shapes ecology. So there is this circle that's going round and round, and we really should recognize this, that they're not too that's not dichotomous. So here is an example of the, anyone? We're going to have this in India soon, guys, come on.
Bullet train.
Exactly. It's called the Shinkansen bullet train. But they had a very peculiar problem, which was every time the, I'm sure anyone heard of this example before? Yes, awesome. So they had a very peculiar problem when they had this in Japan, which was that when the bullet train would enter a tunnel, it would enter it with such force, it travels at about 200 and, sorry, it travels at around 270 kilometers an hour. Sorry, miles an hour. So, kilometers an hour, 270 kilometers an hour. So, it creates a lot of air pressure. As it exits the tunnel, there's a sonic boom which disrupts the residents. So, they got the guy by the name of... Doesn't matter. They got a scientist, and he was a bird watcher. So, he said that, we really need to figure this out. So, he looked at kingfishers. When they splash into the water, they create a minimal disturbance. So he modeled several kingfishers and several versions of their beaks. And not identical, but also tweaking it a little bit here and there to kind of see which one creates that. And he shaped bullets in the same manner as different shapes of the beak and fired them through a pressure tunnel to see which creates the least pressure. And not surprisingly, it was the one that has the king that closestly resembled the kingfisher's beak that had the least disturbance. And so has anyone seen a kingfisher fish? Yeah? So that's great. All about that. So when it enters the water, it nose dives in and with minimal displacement, it can't afford to have too much of a displacement as its payload gets hit. And what was really interesting is not only did it solve that sonic boom problem, but it also made the train 10% faster, 15% more efficient, and there was obviously lesser sound. And this was not based only on the kingfisher. He looked at three birds for that. One was the wings of an owl to create the carcass, the one that the structure that provides power to the train, the overlying ones. He shaped that like the wings of an owl. So when an owl swoops down on its prey, it's soundless. If anyone's ever heard, next time you see an owl fly, to see it, you will not hear a sound, unlike a pigeon or a crow. So because it has to be really stealthy. So that was again to cut resistance. The belly of a penguin, how penguins have these streamlined bodies to help them swim and maneuver through the water. And of course the beak of a kingfisher. So there is this entire field of biomimicry that is really interesting. And that there's a lot to learn from. And I really think that this is awesome because when we look, say, when we're looking for inspiration, we look at other people, we look at other people's work, maybe we go back to the prehistoric times and see what they did. But that's still what, 50,000, 80,000, 100,000 years old? When you're looking at the natural world, it's 3.8 billion years of a data set to learn from. So it's really fascinating. And there's a lot. So architecture can learn from it, processes, ecosystems, everything. I won't get into that right now, but of course I'm very keen on looking at how mutualisms in nature, about how two different species interact to the benefit of both of them. And that can also shape how we create managerial institutions, how we create hierarchies, etc. In organizations. And of course there's an entire world of ecological economics, which is where you assign values or you try and value the ecosystem and what it provides to humans and a bunch of other stuff. Again, that's too much to get into right now, but if anyone's interested, just Google this and you'll get a bunch of literature. Alright, that's it. I think I should open it up for some questions, more questions now. I don't think we have time to talk about all of these now. Yes, we don't have time. Sorry. Yes, absolutely. That's very interesting. So there's a bunch of really cool work that is being done in NCBS itself, the beer lab. So did anyone get that question? How will biodiversity help in the face of climate change, or help climate change, you know, mitigation efforts and stuff like that? So it's a very interesting question. There is a really good amount of work that has been done in NCBS, where we were, at the beer lab, the ecology and ecosystems lab, where they are looking at how drought plays a role. So with changing climates, they're not particularly looking at this, they're looking at drought, but that's a side, if that's what you want to look at a more Indian and African context. But at another level, diversity itself, so suppose there is a drought, alright, and there are certain species that can fare well or do even better in these conditions. So they might be helping with carbon sequestration. A little tangent to this, but yet related, is some of the work that has been done in Nasik, near Nasik in Maharashtra. There's a place called Harishchandragarh. So there's a wonderful bunch of people over there who are documenting the traditions of the Adivasi people, the indigenous people who lived there, what they grew, etc. And Sanjeev over here will also add into that, please feel free to. Where in times of famine, how did people get by? You know, in times of famine, in terms of climatic contingencies, where say water scarcity hits, etc. The indigenous people used to grow crops, some that could do well in times of normalcy, where the water is alright and everything's okay, and also as a buffer, some that yield a little lesser, but are more susceptible, I mean, are more resilient in the face of drought. So that is what they used to subsist on, which is really fascinating to know. And of course, okay, that's another thing. So, yeah, so that's pretty exciting. But I can, after this we can talk a little bit more about that. Any other questions? Yes?
So the indigenous people who had buffer crops were smarter than the banana farmers of the day.
Absolutely, that's it, yeah. That's
even great. After the whole banana thing, that's banana. Like one banana.
Exactly. It's just so counterintuitive, right? It doesn't make sense to us.
Even after big mistakes.
But the same crop. It's just
the same crop. Oh yeah. God, all the bananas. Let's just keep doing the same
thing. Yeah, it's really anyway, just a quick end note, we've got a bunch of people from the course that I'm part of, the MSc in Wildlife Biology and Conservation. This is a fantastic course in Bangalore. It's fully funded, and the best part is people from all walks of life can apply. There's no upper limit to age. There's no requirement of a degree in a science or any of that. They're really looking for that's why they come. That's why they're really looking for these interdisciplinary integrated things. So feel free to catch. Here are the photos. I put the photos so you can catch any one of us around here. For our thesis, we're going to be working all over the country, from Uttarakhand to Assam to the Andaman Nicobar Islands, Nepal, Bangladesh, Lakshadweep, Goa, and just everywhere.
So, is there a lower limit?
You just need a degree. That's all. Awesome. So if you guys come across any photographs of BLiSC mimicry, please send them to me. I'm really trying to compile it all. If you guys come across other forms of, other interesting things that you think are related, please let me know. I'd be happy to.
Maybe a slightly unrelated question.
Yes.
Like in Bombay, as you know, in Bombay, as you know, we have a certain controversy regarding this Arjun forest, which is a forest that's being cut down for building a metro, and they say metro will reduce carbon emissions, and so it's okay to cut the forest. And so they measure the worth of a forest by the number of trees and how much CO2 a particular each tree would reduce. So how would, for example, biodiversity, is there a way to get a metric on what biodiversity in fact does? Because it's not just about trees.
Absolutely. So biodiversity has a bunch of reasons that, you know, they come up. One is, of course, like you mentioned, ecosystem surfaces, which is that they do play a role in the functioning. Some of my colleagues here are going to be working on how biodiversity impacts what we see, how we see forests, you know, in terms of seed dispersal. There are several species of trees which require to go through the gut of an animal to germinate and be and get dispersed as well. Otherwise, how does a tree get from one place to another? And that has in turn an impact on the carbon sequestration value of a forest. Amazing work by Galetti in 2013 in the Amazon, where they figure out that the loss of these biodiversity in the terms of large birds has greatly changed the sequestration capacities of birds of the forest. So that's definitely it. But at a more local level, what you're saying, it's very interesting that you mentioned the RA thing, because the metro, of course, is said to be a greener way, a greener alternative to transport, etc. But where is the power coming from? It's from coal. Which is, again, so it's just the loop twice over. Also, maybe at a global scale, these 50, 100 acres may not make much of an impact. But at a local scale, it does. So it does play a role in terms of air quality, all of that. And there are metrics to value this as well. So that's something that could definitely be looked at, and I'm sure is being looked at. So at a local scale, it is absolutely essential to look at these places. And yeah, and the rhetoric that, oh, you know, what is this small patch going to do when, you know, these guys are chopping down acres and acres of forest is not, this what about argument is never really sustainable, particularly in such places. So, and of course, I'm sure you know about RA, just since you mentioned it. Mumbai, okay, can anybody guess which place in the world has the world's highest density of leopards? Sorry, man. But yeah, that was Mumbai. Mumbai, it's more than Kruger National Park, more than Kruger National Park, more than anywhere in the world, it's Mumbai. And they're seemingly existing in really well, on really good terms with humans. And there's a bunch of work, again, over there. You guys can check out Project Wagoba, which again looks at this, and it's really interesting, really fascinating work about how leopards also are changing, and humans also are accepting. It's fantastic. And we went there for a field visit, and it really rattled us as ecologists, you know, because we hear about a national park and then a buffer zone and then this is for animals. But over there, all of that is thrown out of the window. The leopard is just walking through building playgrounds, between cars, picking up sleeping dogs from corridors. And it's fantastic. It's fascinating. So, yeah, there's another lovely movie made on this called 21st Century Cats. It's on YouTube, so you guys can check that out. Awesome. Thank you guys. Thank you. Time for questions. Anyone would like to ask anything? Yes. Can you pass the mic down, please? Okay. Again, at NCBS, there are two labs that are working on bees. Fascinating work. One of them is looking at pollution's impact on them, and the other is looking at their physiology, etc., and how they are working together and all of that. But it's very interesting. The ecosystem services provided by bees is phenomenal, and so much so that, you know, generally evaluation to an ecosystem service like this is a little bit more theoretical. But in California, they're really famous for these apples, and there are no bees. So what do? So they've got people whose job is to hand pollinate flowers of apple. And so you have a straight away metric for that. And the numbers are astonishing. You know, you have to pay them like a huge amount of money for that, and yet they're not able to do even a fraction of the work that the bees do. I mean, the efficiency is really low. So it's crazy. And there is, yeah, and the global decline of insects is something that we should be really, really concerned about. Absolutely, absolutely. I can't remember who said it. I think it was Einstein or something. He said that if the bee vanishes off the earth, so will mankind, or something to that effect. It's very interesting. And another interesting stat, very recently, I think just a few months ago, was a global study published where they found that global insect populations have declined by over 73%. So it's crazy. And they call this the windshield effect. So I don't know, earlier, probably a few decades earlier, when people used to drive, they used to have a problem of the insects hitting their windscreen and getting splattered all over it.
And now people, you know, look back and say, wait a minute, we don't see that anymore. So maybe there is a decline. So that's kind of what started this. It's really fascinating. Yes. Yes.
I think the way network and data in Dubai is probably the way to conserve higher leopards. Just let them grow up. Not going to trap. The leopards won't touch you as long as they're dogs.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, that's absolutely it, you know, because dogs are about 43% of the leopards died in Mumbai. So it's crazy. And there is, in fact, a few of our colleagues work over there, and one of them was telling us they do these camera trappings, right? And they do some kind of scat analysis and all, and they say that there is one individual leopard that is almost a huge majority of its prey is from the bandicoot rats. So it's humans are subsidizing leopards' food, essentially. So it's really crazy, right? And yeah, and over the past few years, there have been very few, I think, close to no, one or two attacks on humans. Yeah, so it's really phenomenal.
So after seeing all of these things, maybe don't you think...
Can you use the mic, please?
No, it's okay. I can't...
No, it's because we're recording the talk, so okay. we need to hear you.
Fine. So don't you think that after seeing all this comparison between animals, creatures, whatever it is, homosexuals are the dangerous people in the world?
Yeah, I mean, I think that goes without a doubt.
Okay. So if that is the case, like everybody believes that we are the only things that do damage stuff for our own say insects. We create so much fertilizers and stuff and so many things are not even coming. So which was coming and now they are seeing like, okay, something is different. Yeah, and they are able to make their own biotics, antibiotics and stuff, they are able to survive. But still, we are still making damage. But at the parallel, we are thinking of like making biodiversity. It's still in name sake and there it is like I feel. So how do you think these things look? So it's basically problem is with us.
Absolutely.
I don't see any problem with insects or animals or anything, plants, till now at least in my experience. So how do you think? So it's not just doing research on insects and plants, right? We have to think on our like attitude and our way of living and stuff, right? Don't you guys do some research on our things? It's not up to the biological studies.
Absolutely. I think that is on the dot a very, very, very important point, which is that there is something like fundamental research, which is about animals and all that. And the other is more of conservation research, which is at the end of the day, there is no problem with the animal side of it. It is with the human side, right? The animal is doing its thing. And so therefore, we need to integrate how people think. So that's why what I'm going to be working on my thesis is about elephants and solar fences. You know, about what enables humans to maintain these socio-ecological things. We are over here going to be working on otters and people's fishermen's perceptions to that and how they are basing their decisions on what they understand. So it is the human side of things. And Dee over here has done a lot of work on that. So she's worked on bears and on leopards as well. So that's something that is really now, it's, you know, coming to the surface. I think that's a very, very fair point that you're making. And just a little addition to that, it's that biodiversity itself, you know, it's the saying over here is, you know, save Earth, save biodiversity. But I think that's the most bullshit statement. Sorry. I think that's the most incorrect statement that you can have. Because bullshit statement that you can have. I think that biodiversity will continue to live long after humans and has been there long before humans. So when we talk about saving the Earth, we're talking about saving ourselves. That's all. Of course, you know, so yeah, undoubtedly, and I'm really glad that you brought about the social science and the anthropological side of it. Because at the end of the day, humans are making decisions based on what they perceive of the natural world. If people think that elephants are, you know, an avatar of Ganesh Bhagwan, they're not going to do anything to it. But if they perceive it as a cruel thing that the forest department has gotten there to make their lives miserable, they are obviously going to retaliate. So, you know, and they're making, and that has nothing to do with the elephant. That is about how they perceive it. So again, that's very important, and I think that's something that we are slowly trying to address. And well, just another bit, that is why we're also going to take this kind of a talk to schools and colleges to tell people that it is not some alien science happening in a lab, you know, it's happening everywhere around you. So, and I think that students try to catch them when they're young, it's most easier to kind of. And terms of sheer volume is all the people who are living their other lives, you know, corporate houses, businesses and all, because if they have even a little bit more of an understanding of how this works and why it's necessary, we can influence their decisions at that scale, you know, which is way more than conservationists can do. Which is something I think we should recognize. Thank you. Yeah.
Find a space in the city somewhere, not in an institution, not in an auditorium, not in a lecture hall, but a space like this where people can just sit comfortably, you know, on a weekend morning and just chat about things. We try not to make the talks too pedagogical. We don't want it to be, we want you to come and study here. We want you to come and chat about science. So it's not a monologue, it's a dialogue, it's a conversation. And that's what we try to encourage. And we believe that science is not something that happens there when people are here. Science is around us. And the point of these talks is so all of us can gain a little more awareness of exactly what the science is around us, inside us, outside us. And this is the purpose of the talks. So, this particular session has been special because we're doing something a little different. We're talking, first of all, we usually use faculty members to come and give talks. This time we've asked students to give a talk. And I'm really glad that we did this because this has been one of the most interesting talks ever. Thank you so much.